Every time a vote was inconclusive, the paper ballots were burned with damp straw to produce black smoke. Three days later, after 11 votes had been taken, the 50 cardinals bent their heads toward the throne, toward one man. The world had a new pope. Outside the Vatican, the crowd still did not know the outcome of the 11th vote. Both traditionalists and reformers within the church believed a compromise had been reached, a pope who would serve in a transitional period and stay the course for a few years. But this pope surprised them. In the conclave, the newly elected man was asked whether he accepted his election as head of the church and what name he would choose. From this point on, Christ's representative on earth proceeded to rule like an absolute monarch, responsible only to God and to his conscience. White smoke rose. Darkness had fallen by the time the oldest serving cardinal announced the new pope, as prescribed by ancient ritual. He was Angelo Giuseppe Roncalli. At age 77, he became known as Pope John the 23rd. The square erupted in celebration, but around the world there was amazement. Who was this new man?
When I heard his name as the new Archbishop of Vienna, I thought to myself, well, Pius XII loomed large in the Church's hierarchy, but this new Pope seems more humble. Can that work? It must be a temporary arrangement.
But the new Pope was underestimated. He surprised everyone. With great fanfare, changes were announced by the Church. A second Vatican Council was called, the first assembly of bishops in almost 100 years. Critics regarded this pope as the biggest catastrophe of the century. His fans considered him a saint.
He was deeply influenced by evangelism. At the same time, he was very humane and tended to sense intuitively what was possible and what was impossible. He was able to lead the church in a new direction. The church essentially emerged from the Middle Ages because of him.
This visionary came from a simple family. He was the son of a farmer from Bergamo, Italy. Loris Capovilla, his secretary and companion for many years, kept valuable keepsakes from Pope John the 23rd. They included the Pope's diary, a first in the 2,000-year history of the church. These were the Pope's thoughts.
The moment he walked back in from the balcony, he spoke to me. I was blinded by the light, and I said to myself, if you aren't humble and gentle in your heart, you'll be completely blind to the suffering and pain throughout the world. Be as humble and gentle as Jesus Christ our Lord.
Humble he was, but not inactive. As an archbishop, he had carried out the work of the Holy See in Istanbul. John was a diplomat. worst crimes of the century were committed around him. Mass murder had been planned in cold blood. But for the Jews persecuted in the Balkans, Roncalli had been a savior. He rescued 20,000 of them from death.
Everywhere I went, I heard the same story. We can't help, with one exception. In Istanbul, I met a fat little archbishop named Roncalli, who was the papal nuncio in Turkey. He got up from his chair when I told him what was going on, what was happening to the Jews, started to cry, put his arms around me, and said, "Rabbi, what can I do to help?"
He was named nuncio in liberated France in 1944, cardinal 9 years later. But Roncalli was not admitted to the top ranks of the church. When he was named Patriarch of Venice, many thought that was the end of the line for the farmer's son from Bergamo. Then, Pope Pius XII died in Rome. In preparation for a conclave, the Sistine Chapel was turned into a voting station, complete with sleeping accommodations. One theologian explained the criteria the cardinals used to choose a new pope.
Cheerful, maybe more than that, not too intelligent. That's what the other cardinals look for. Someone they can see through.
Did that describe John? Was he papal material? When the conclave met, Roncalli was not the first choice. But he sensed something. An entry in his diary betrays his excitement.
I'm sure he was convinced he would be chosen as Pope. When he said goodbye to me, he commented that we would see each other next time in Venice, or somewhere else.
The College of Cardinals was not so sure. It took them 4 days. Finally, an agreement was reached in the 11th round of voting. But had they found the lowest common denominator?
I was sitting with the other secretaries, and suddenly someone asked, "Is Monsignore Capovilla here?" And at that moment, I knew my Cardinal Roncalli had been chosen. I went through the Sistine Chapel into the little sacristy, and he was already there, putting on the white papal robes.
White smoke rose into the sky, but behind the scenes, there was frantic activity. The new papal robes were too tight. The tailors had not considered this candidate, so when he gave his first blessing, the Pope could barely raise his arms. But the crowd still cheered. "Everyone loves me," he said, "except the tailor."
And then he said that anyone could become Pope. He was proof of that.
A new wind blew through the Vatican. Staff members were among the first to notice. The new man wanted to meet them all and listen to them all. The Pope said a good shepherd has to know every member of his flock.
The first audiences were in the afternoon. Afterward, we asked people what their first meeting with the new Pope was like, and the people came out shaking their heads, saying it was strange. Why? He told them jokes.
He also seemed carefree in public. His predecessors had towered above everyone else. Pope John was not condescending. At a press conference, he called out to journalists, "I'm Joseph, your brother."
We were used to a domineering pope whose favorite gesture was a blessing. Now we had a pope who used to get out his handkerchief and blow his nose when the cameras were on him.
It went even further. The third floor of the Apostles' Palace, sealed off from the outside world, was the most intimate sphere of a pope's existence. This pope allowed people inside. A film crew followed the pope into his private rooms. Here was the pope's bedroom. Radio Vatican. His canaries. This had never happened before, and not everyone was pleased.
There were certain misgivings. Although his characteristics seemed very appealing to the outside world, his spontaneity and sincerity were not always considered appropriate for a pope.
For Pope John the 23rd, it was more than that. When he was crowned, his message was very clear. Education, diplomacy, a talent for organization are all well and good, but they are no substitute for being a good shepherd to the entire flock.
It was a total change in papal image, from pious, aristocratic and devoted to a hierarchy, to a pope who liked to describe himself as a peasant. He wanted to be a good shepherd to everyone, and the Romans gave him the affectionate nickname Faccioccone, which means something like fat joker.
This is the Lateran Basilica, the church of the Bishop of Rome. For John, his papacy was no empty ritual. He really wanted to do spiritual work, to be the good shepherd in the eternal city. He wanted to be a pope you could reach out and touch. If someone couldn't come to him, the pope went to them. Pope John visited a children's hospital on Christmas Eve. A 9-year-old orphan shared his Christian name. "My name's Angelo too," said the Pope, "but they've given me another name now." Pope John even went to the prisons. The head of the Roman Catholic Church rubbed shoulders with thieves, pimps, and murderers. The Pope revealed that he once stole something when he was a little boy. "An apple," he said. "I was lucky. Nobody caught me. Of course, I couldn't give it back. I'd eaten it." It was the kind of story that made an impact. He was more than a fat joker.
They wanted a transitional pope who would not be around for very long, who would be open to influence and would not try anything new. They made a mistake.
"Habemus opapum," here is your grandfather, was how they teased him. Their humor was not lost on the pope. The world had witnessed huge changes. How would the church cope? You ain't nothing but a hound dog. In Castel Gandolfo, Pope John searched for an answer through prayer.
That was the week he had the idea that it was finally time to summon another council. But his own immediate reaction to the idea was that it would be impossible. The preparations had not been made. How could it be managed? It was a whisper from the evil one.
How could a council be the work of the devil? The Council of Bishops had met 20 times in the history of the church. The last had been 100 years earlier. At that time, it was decided that the Pope is infallible. Given that position, the Council of Bishops became superfluous. The Pope could answer all questions himself. But did that include this one?
He supposedly said on one occasion, "I know the Pope can be infallible when he makes certain statements, when he is speaking ex cathedra from the throne of St. Peter, but I do not intend to sit there."
Pope John the 23rd took his role as a bishop seriously. It was not that he had an agenda for the council, but he sensed that the doors and windows of the church had to be flung open. How that would be done remained to be seen. While strolling in the Vatican, John shared his intentions with his secretary.
One day, he told me we needed a council. Just like that, almost casually. Nearly a month later, just before Christmas, he said, "The way things are going, I feel I have to try. I have to throw a net into the sea. I have to risk the council."
On January 25th, 1959, the Curia Cardinals were also informed. There was a mass in St. Paul's before the walls of Rome. Impromptu meeting was then held in the monastery next door. Pope John announced his decision. There would be a new Vatican Council. There was silence from the cardinals. "To tell you the truth," said Pope John, "we thought the cardinals would be clamoring to congratulate us." But papal decisions are not commented upon. Anything new is greeted with suspicion.
The comparison is to a fortress. The church has to protect itself, guard against mistakes, pull up the drawbridge, close the windows, and wait for better times to come.
But Pope John the 23rd did not want to wait. Many of the cardinals were horrified. They accused the Pope of acting prematurely, without sufficient thought. In the mouthpiece of the Curia, the announcement of the council did not rate headlines. Just a small announcement.
"It is impossible to overestimate the importance of the Curia's resistance to the council. Of course, it was all hidden."
But believers all over the world were openly euphoric. Pope John's slogan about the modernization of the church created a sense of new beginnings. There were hopes for reform, without a clear sense of what those changes would be. But not everyone was as enthusiastic as the flock and its shepherd.
Adenauer told me on two occasions that he couldn't understand how the Pope could summon a council without a plan and without having determined in advance how everything would proceed.
An official signing of a summons for the council followed.
Adenauer
The Pope's aim was clear, though his path to reach it was not. The Pope left the practical preparations to a commission. Men like these were supposed to reform the church. Were they suited to the task?
I think it was a very big mistake on the part of Pope John the 23rd. It was like setting up a government inquiry, but putting the official, who was the subject of the inquiry, in charge of it.
The members of the commission were united. There was general agreement. The council was to protect, limit, and defend a siege mentality.
Basically, there was a small group of bishops, some cardinals, some from the Curia, who were deeply concerned that the true nature of the church could be undermined, its true nature altered.
That had to be avoided at all costs. They stalled. After all, the Pope was old. In Rome, tactics were discussed over the evening meal. But for the Pope, there was no time to waste. He visited the suburbs of Rome. These pictures are deceptive. This was a missionary area. A synod was to be convened, an assembly of all Rome's clerics. It would be a dress rehearsal for the council. For his critics from the Curia, this amounted to papal interference.
This synod was something quite new. Of course, it is quite understandable for every pope to attempt a highly personal achievement, to want to create something new. But it was very, very difficult for Pope John the 23rd to develop new initiatives after such a long pontificate.
The priests of Rome were to embody the Pope's hopes for the future. But the church is not a place for democratic debate. The result was a restrictive code of behavior for priests. They wore cassocks and shaved their heads. They couldn't go to the movies or get into a car unless it was an emergency. There was a return to the text of the Bible. The washing of feet on Maundy Thursday was brought back. The Pope's opponents breathed a sigh of relief. If the council progressed like the synod, it would be the most harmless in history.
At first, when the council was announced, it was natural for people to have expectations. And then the Roman synod took place. This lowered our expectations. It even made some people pessimistic.
In August of 1961, the Berlin Wall went up. From the Kremlin, Khrushchev placed a roadblock in the Eastern Bloc's only remaining route to freedom. His servant lied through his teeth.
Niemand hat die Absicht, eine Mauer zu errichten.
The world faced the abyss.
Verantwortung, dafür trägt der Osten.
There was concern in the Vatican. State Secretary Tardini informed the Pope. What could the Holy Father do? Talk to the communists?
Hanno preso alcune flash
They were filming while the Pope and Tardini were talking. You can see quite clearly his finger on a map, circling Berlin. And he is saying, another war can't break out because of a city.
Would there be war over a city? Nikita Khrushchev did not want war either, but he threatened it. Then, the impossible happened. From Castel Gandolfo, the Pope sent a dramatic appeal to the world for peace over Radio Vatican. It was clearly aimed at Moscow.
I popoli sconfitti, esso ha bisogno, ma di salute rinnovata e più robusta, di pace feconda e rasserenatrice.
It was the first time a Pope had appealed directly to the Kremlin.
I remember the time when Pope Pius XII declared there should be no contact and no conversation with the communist world. And now, suddenly, things have changed completely.
Khrushchev reacted by having Pravda publish an article praising the Pope's appeal for peace. Six weeks later, a sensation. A telegram from Moscow arrived, congratulating Pope John on his 80th birthday.
I was on the way to the Vatican, just like every day. Then a car from the State Secretariat pulled up, tires squealing, and I was asked to get in. It was very urgent. We had to prepare an answer to Khrushchev's telegram. This had never happened before.
Excitement filled the Apostles' Palace. A breathless cardinal presented the Holy Father with Khrushchev's telegram. The Pope took it calmly.
Eminenza, meglio una carezza che non...
Your Eminences, said the Pope, a friendly gesture is better than a slap in the face, isn't it? Then he fell silent before continuing. Your Eminences, it could be a trick, a pretense, an attempt to exploit me, but it could also be a thread handed to me by Providence. And in that case, I do not have the right to break this thread.
Informal overtures were made. Here were two peasants' sons, worlds apart, yet seemingly understanding one another. Sent feelers out to other East Bloc countries. He wanted to ease the plight of Catholics oppressed there. He also wanted to make it possible for as many bishops as possible to attend his council. His critics were horrified once again. They labeled him naive.
And then he said to me, in Vienna, you aren't far away from Budapest, are you? Why don't you go and visit Cardinal Mincenti in Budapest? I said, well, I'd like nothing better, but the Iron Curtain meant that an archbishop from Vienna couldn't do that. And he said, well, you go to the station and buy your ticket, and things will be just fine.
At the western end of the Vatican City, Pope John had an old tower renovated, the Tower of San Giovanni. But it was not named after him. He withdrew here to conserve his strength. The preparations for the council were taking too long. Was the resistance from the outside, or was it because of him? Pope John refused to give up. He said,
when they elected me Pope, they said I was a transitional figure. Well, this is the fourth year of our pontificate. We have a huge agenda ahead of us, and we're going to work on it.
The Holy Father left Rome. He went to Assisi and Loreto to campaign for the success of the council. People showered him with good wishes. Meanwhile, nothing new happened in Rome. The organizers from the Curia prepared 70 drafts. They all had one thing in common: they were not concrete. Would the church throughout the world accept the Curia's delay tactics?
I must say, I sometimes find this one-sided attitude very irritating. The Curia on one side and the world church on the other. But as members of the Curia, we are also members of the world church.
The beginning of the council concealed these tensions for a while. October 11, 1962, 2,500 participants from 133 countries converged on Rome.
All of them with mitres on their heads, different skin colors, different languages, different races. Yes, the church is very colorful. I had imagined we would all be able to speak Latin and all have white skins. That was my unconscious idea. I'll never forget how tense I felt, wondering how it would all work out.
After 3 years of tiring preparations, wrote Pope John XXIII in his diary, we have reached the foot of the holy mountain. May the Lord be with us to lead us to a propitious conclusion. This is the high point of John Paul's pontificate. But the Pope seemed pale and exhausted. Only a few people knew what he had been told by his doctors.
They issued a bulletin at the time, and they had invented a very nice way of putting it. He was said to be suffering from stomach trouble, which could mean anything from indigestion to cancer. His doctor confided to me that it was cancer in the final stages.
Pope John did not want anyone to be denied the joy of the council. He knew his time on earth was coming to an end. He changed his will to read, I wait calmly and peacefully for Brother Death.
When the Pope came in to the St. Peter's, he came in for maybe 20% of that main aisle, and he stopped. And he had them set down this chair, and then he walked up the aisle. And in retrospect, we said, right from the beginning, he was giving us some little message, this is going to be a different affair.
At the opening ceremony, Pope John expressed himself clearly. The theme of the council would be modernization. In addition, he sent an unambiguous message to those with doubts.
Ut non sine aurium nostrarum offensiore, corundum voces ad nos perferantur. Qui licet religionis studio incensi, non sapis tamen equa estimatione prudentique judicio res perpendum. Ad nobis plane dissentiendum esse videtur, apis rerum adversarum vaticinatoribus.
It wasn't until the opening speech that a great wave of hope and expectation developed. because only then did Pope John state that the days of the prophets of doom were over. Those who maintained that the world was an evil place and the church existed to convert the world.
The very next day, the conflict between the Curia and the World Church was exposed during the election of members to the various working groups. The candidates had been proposed by the Curia, who wanted to maintain control. But there was opposition.
The Roman Curia is still the organ of an absolute monarch. If you look at it in constitutional terms, the Pope is at least as powerful as Louis XIV was. If he wanted, he could really get anything passed by the Curia.
Bishops from around the world were annoyed. France's Cardinal Leonhardt and Cologne's Cardinal Frings wanted the council elders themselves to choose the candidates for the working groups. But they were not allowed to speak until they forcibly took control of the microphone. There was an uproar.
There was a burst of applause when Cardinal Frings spoke. He was almost blind. But in his clear voice, using very precise Latin, he announced that the present arrangement was unacceptable and that a new commission should be elected by the council itself. This was the moment the council began breaking new ground.
The proposal was passed by a large majority, and the session adjourned. The bishops went home. The postponement of the council was misunderstood at first.
We were in the press room when people suddenly started saying, "It's all over. How could it be all over? It had only begun half an hour earlier."
In fact, now it really began. French and German bishops reacted immediately. Working through the night, they produced a new list of candidates. The council developed its own dynamic, but it still lacked an agenda.
In that sense, Pope John was not entirely realistic. The 2,500 bishops would not simply call out Amen like the angels in the apocalypse and then go home. Suddenly, the problems of the entire world had become important.
There were enough problems to fuel debate for decades. The Cardinal of Milan brought order to this confusion. On 11 handwritten sheets of paper, he proposed a clear agenda, concise and well-organized. The majority of the council elders supported him, and so the future of the council was assured. The cardinal from Milan was called Montini. He would be the next pope.
At the time, I thought to myself, this is the voice of the next pope. And everyone was certain that Pope John would not live to see a second session of the council because of his health.
On October 15, 1962, U.S. reconnaissance photographs clearly showed Soviet missiles deployed in Cuba. President Kennedy imposed a sea blockade.
Of significant capacity for the Soviet Union.
Nikita Khrushchev decided to bluff. Soviet ships set a course for Cuba. The world was on the brink of nuclear disaster. What could the Pope do besides pray?
And on the conflict, which in this case could well have meant a nuclear war, would have brought about the complete end of civilization. It was necessary to find a way out of this situation. That became clear to the Pope at exactly the moment that it also became clear to Khrushchev on one side and Kennedy on the other.
Could the man in the Vatican offer a way out? Pope John appealed to the superpowers to find a peaceful solution.
Nous supplions tous les gouvernants de ne pas rester sourds à ce cri de l'humanité, qu'ils fassent tout ce qui est en eux pour sauver la paix. Ils éviteront ainsi au monde les horreurs d'une guerre dont nul ne peut prévoir quelles seraient les effroyables conséquences.
The Pope spoke in the interest of the whole world in an attempt to preserve peace, to save the situation. That was what made him so popular and made so many people around the world trust him.
Then a miracle happened. The Soviets backed down. The world was saved, thanks in part to John the 23rd. Peace on Earth became the title of his last encyclical.
Amen.
He demanded honor and justice for all mankind. Above all, he gave an impassioned plea for peace in the face of an impending nuclear disaster. This became the legacy of Pope John.
It was immensely important for the Church. For the first time, a papal document dealt with more than strictly religious truths. It dealt with a human problem, peace.
Peace on Earth became the first encyclical with a soundtrack. The world applauded the Pope. Time magazine named him Man of the Year. In Rome, he was honored with the Balzan Peace Prize. But there was sorrow amid the joy.
He looked as if he were made of alabaster, almost transparent. The doctors advised him against coming, but he was always so kind that he couldn't refuse, despite his condition.
A chain of lights penetrated the night for the people's Pope. No other Pope had been so loved and honored. Papa Giovanni was a man on the throne of the Pope.
Sento le vostre voci, la mia è una voce sola, ma riassume la voce del mondo intero. Qui tutto il mondo è rappresentato. Si direbbe che persino la luna si è affrettata stasera, osservatela in alto, a guardare a questo spettacolo. Tornando a casa, troverete i bambini. Date una carezza ai vostri bambini e dite questa è la carezza del Papa. Troverete qualche lacrima da asciugare. Fate qualche, dite una parola buona. Il Papa è con noi, specialmente nelle ore della tristezza e dell'amarezza. E poi tutti insieme ci animiamo.
The rumors became more insistent that the Pope was very sick and did not have long to live. And he said himself, my suitcase is packed. I'm ready.
In 1963, Pope John was dying. In St. Peter's Square, thousands of people prayed for him. Medical bulletins were read every hour over loudspeakers. On Friday, May 31st, the doctors surrendered the fight. John's cancer could no longer be controlled. His old companion kept watch at his bedside.
The Pope said, if I lie like this with the crucifix over my head, I can't see it. He had the crucifix placed on the wall across from him. At one point during his final hours, his nephew got in the way by mistake, and the Pope said, if you stand there, I can't see Jesus, our Lord, who was crucified. Move aside a little.
The last thing he saw was that crucifix. Pope John died on Monday, just before 8 o'clock in the evening. According to ancient custom, the gates of the Vatican were locked to mourn the death of the Pope. These were the last thoughts of the Pope John.
He was very calm, as if he were looking over a threshold and could see his predecessors waiting for him. He said, my time on this earth is at an end, but Christ is alive, and the Church will continue his work. The souls we shall one day see. Those were his last words.
Not everyone has the same opinion of Pope John. Many honor him as a saint, but some seem prepared to go to any length to prevent his beatification. This included attacks on his character. There were allegations that he was homosexual.
Something like that would have been totally impossible. Quite inconceivable. And after I had replied twice to questions like that, I went to see Cardinal Palazzini and asked him what motivated him to ask those questions. All right, it isn't true, but the council was his fault.
Pope John's last words could just as well pertain to his opponents. If I have injured anyone, I ask for forgiveness. And if anyone was dissatisfied with my attitude or my actions, I ask him to be patient with me. In my last hours, I am at peace and am certain that my God in his mercy will not turn me away.